Boy, you're welcome.
To the barber shop.
You're welcome.
To the barber shop.
You are welcome to the Barbershop, indeed, Barbershop Podcast. You're welcome to come this Wednesday, next Wednesday, any Wednesday, live on Twitch TV, or check us out on YouTube. Listen to us on iTunes. Find us on the interweb. It's not hard to do. It's a beautiful thing, Barbershop Podcast, broadcasting from Boxo Studio in the shadow of the great Hamilton Mountain, the great city of Hamilton, Ontario, the blast furnace of live original music. And for over 216 weeks, we have been pounding out the very best from not only Hamilton, but from the surrounding areas. We do let some outsiders in from time to time, from Toronto and the other side and down Lake Erie Way. And it's just so much great music out there. You people either know, that's why you're watching it, because you're super fans. You love someone that you saw on the show. You're discovering new people on the show, or you're a newbie. You somehow were led to this. This is perhaps the first time you ever saw this show. Well, you're in for a treat. You know, they're all good, but I guarantee you this one's going to be one of the truly great ones. And not just because Ryan Cannon and Gary Greenland are here. It's an absolute treat to have you guys in. Killer. I guess I should look this way, even though, like, you know, you're actually there for the camera. I would say that you're there. How are you doing, guys? Good. You don't have a microphone because we have a giant band tonight? Okay. But otherwise, things are going good? Excellent. Multi-tracking on Pro Tools. Wicked system. We've got multi-computers going. It's crazy. It's good. And you're going to notice it. You're going to hear it. You're going to see it tonight because Eyerollers are in. They were in before as the Kents in the early days. The Royal Kents. They are a combination of the Marshall Brothers. Stuart Marshall Grant Marshall. I don't know why I brain farted on that, Grant. And John Connolly. God knows we love John Connolly. And that's so good. And Dave Christie on the Skins. They, you know, if you don't know who they are, you're going to know who they are now. They are funny. They are bright. They are gear sluts. They always have beautiful instruments. And I'm not talking about their penises, you know. I'm sure, you know, what's on their own. And it's like the guitars are good. The music, it always stands up. And
it's okay.
It's okay. And I'm going to say, hey, guys, thanks for coming in. How
Hello,
you doing?
Kevin Barber.
Thank
Hello.
You, Kev.
How it is, and I'm doing great. It's the end of February.
That's great.
But you kind of did just by your presence here, and you're like, "How are you doing, Kev?" Go on to a giant rambling soliloquy, and you've been a fan of that for years. And I got to say, John, I appreciate because you've liked it from the get go. You kind of got what we were doing here at Barbershop Podcast.
I'm a huge fan of you.
Of what we're doing here.
Gary Greenlight. See, and when it was embarrassing because I introduced myself to Gary tonight, and I didn't know his name.
Yeah.
I had to go, hey, I'm John. He's like, I'm Gary. I'm like, I know who you are. I know exactly who you are, Gary.
And there's been, of the first bunch of people who got it and who loved it and understood, it's like, oh, it's a fickle business, this music. You have to endear yourself and worm yourself into someone's heart and trust box somehow, right? And you do that through so precious few vehicles. They're not really out there. And especially for a band like you guys, you got what we do, and you're always a supporter. And sometimes people think, wow, you know, look at those guys, the show's slick. And I guarantee you, it's a lot slicker if you go back to the days when John started watching and it wasn't so slick. But the heart was in it. And the dedication to kind of get better and have a good time and take yourself seriously. Don't take yourself too seriously. Take what you do seriously. It's kind of a mantra, you know, what you guys have done. And let's have a little celebration of rock and roll. Tell us about why the name change for the band, and because the cast is there and the sound is there. What's the kind of progression of the band, where you find yourself now?
You gonna take it? I'll take it.
Sure.
The name change is because of there was a band being played on the CBC, mm-hmm. our beloved CBC,
yes.
by the way, called the Kents, a bunch of young upstarts.
Yeah, they went and did all
From
that
the
legal
Peterborough
stuff.
Area.
Yeah, stole our name. So we thought, well, it's a shit name anyway, so let's just change it.
I like that. You guys having played around enough and seen enough good music, and by good music, you know what I'm talking about. I'm not being snotty by that at all, just understanding that it's not every once in a while you stumble upon someone who's great. It's all the time. It's everywhere. You still have a kind of a great stamp of what you do. Have you just continued on? Is this, if someone was to say, how different is this music from maybe where it was a couple of years ago? Like, did you consciously change it?
I mean, I like to think that we get better.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we'd like to think that.
What are the elements, you know, because, like, I'll throw them out, the ones I hear, you know. It's like, there's a certain degree of pageantry. It's sparkly, I like to say, and not to demean it, like it's, cartoony, sparkly, but it shimmers. It has a, that Sunday night thing where, you know, when Disney did come on and you were a kid, there was a, you know, a substance to it. And I think it harkens back to, you know, perhaps the Beatlesque, you know,
yeah, there's definitely that.
Yeah, we're definitely up there with the Beatles.
Yeah, because or perhaps better. You get that all the time. But influences stay with you, right? You at a certain point you're like, I'm of a certain station in life. I'm not really looking to reinvent myself all the time. I want to play the music I like.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to get a couple Casios and
no, we're not making
start
beatboxing
to out a Kid A. Fuck off.
Yeah.
We like guitars. We like guitars.
Yeah.
And we like jean jackets, obviously.
Yeah.
And melodies.
That's what we do. That's
melodies and harmonies.
Yeah.
And there's a certain lushness, too. I think that you have to give a, you know, we all went through a period where stripped down music was lauded, but, you know, a little makeup on something that's pretty to start with is a nice thing.
Yeah.
Why don't you hit us with something right off the bat? I like live music. We're going to start with live music. What's the first live tune you're going to play? What are you going to play for us first?
We're going to play both ways.
You have no ideas? Both ways? The name of song, anything you want to tell us about that one?
Grant's
sexuality.
Okay, that's what I needed to hear.
That's really great. That's pretty good.
Okay, you're going to hear it right here, right now, live. Yep. Barbershoppodcast.com.
Is it 'cause I rule the world?
is so good. Eyerollers here, Barbershop Podcast. Power pop, I don't know what you want to call it.
Sure,
It is, because, and just recently there was a thing going around on the interweb where people were kicking off with their 10 records from high school that they remember that was influential on them, what they remember.
Yes.
And one of the ones that I picked out that was Cheap Trick, live at Budokan, and then certainly Dream Police after
you
that.
You were in high school then?
Yeah, like way back when, and so were you.
truly,
truly old man.
Was it?
Yeah. Those boys, those brothers have in the whole band has been, you know, redeemed as one of the greats. And
yeah, they're amazing. Yeah, love Cheap Trick.
Yeah, and that... I don't know if it's been owned, if it's supposed to be an Indianapolis or a Milwaukee sound or a, you know, a California sound or whatever. But it's on the way over, I heard the early 90s, you know, when Fall Out Boy and you had a lot of these kind of bands that had elements of music, you know, kind of those sparkly, jumpy pop, you know, something at a different higher octane level. But something almost that's intergenerational and intersexual, that boys can like it and girls can like it too. It's a tough little gig. Are you mathematical when you like write, or is it like, or you just kind of write for what feels? And is it ever stem from like the baseline, or you come with something that's mostly done?
It's usually if something is, if it's pretty, I guess. I mean, usually it stems from melody.
Yeah, I like that kind of stuff too.
Yeah.
You know, it's, sit down with the guitar and play some chords. Oh, that sounds pretty good. Try hum something, some gibberish over top.
So you got stuff partly done, somewhat done, bringing ideas and fleshing them out. Yeah.
Yeah, that's...
Yeah.
And the majority of songs, that's how we do it. It's just to get arrangements and... Because everybody, should have input.
Yeah.
You know?
That's true.
Except for the drums. We don't really...
I can't do that.
Dave wants to play guitar and harmonica.
Everyone wants to do
it. True.
Every athlete wants
to
do it.
By the way, Dave
actor.
Can play guitar and
he's
harmonica.
Probably a better singer and guitar player than me and Grant.
Amazing number of drummers are, I found.
Yeah.
You know, you do for a minute. Very don't
he knows what we're playing.
Yeah.
Note wise and theory.
Do you find that when you play? Because there's like different, you know, like melodic drummers who are kind of seminal, and then playing in bands like that. Definitely Keith Moon comes to mind, but lots of people who, you know.
I prefer
seminal.
Seminal. Yeah. Well, that's where it comes from, you know. Yeah. It's from the origin, just like semen is, if you want to get very scientific about it, you know. It's not funny. It's factual. It's factual.
That wasn't.
Yeah.
I didn't mean
you're going for the cheap laugh. And
I
don't do that around here.
It's like improv. We do
the angry berating here mostly.
Yes. Mostly.
And the passive aggression.
So let's get back to talking about this.
Okay, yeah. So and so
our band practices are a lot of that. A lot of passive aggressive, a lot of yelling.
Backhanded compliments.
It's not friendly.
We're yelling because we're playing so loudly in a space that is smaller than this.
Yeah.
So occasionally you have to, in order to be heard, you have to. Yeah,
it's true.
You have to scream up.
Yeah. Power and volume. Get your elbows out. there's that blue-eyed rock and roll, that post-World War II kind of sound The Who and the Stones and Jeff Beck and so many people gave birth to guitar rock. You know, I was a definite product addict. You know, I remember how I felt when the guitar was they attempted to usurp it in the 80s and put a saxophone. Everyone had to have a saxophone player or a keyboard. And these were monosynths at the time, so there weren't even complex lines. They were just like a telephone tone, and the guitars were reduced to padding in the background and things like that. It was a shameful time.
Yeah,
it
bad was tone.
Bad tone.
Even the sax. I mean, I'm not a huge fan of saxophone in songs, but in the 80s, it was just awful sounding. It was just a bad tone.
Everything was triggered, and everything had to have a huge amount of reverb and this kind of dance
the drums.
Hall.
The drums were like wet drums.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like you never heard anything.
You never heard
that
anything
was actually
like a drum.
Anything acoustic sounding, right? It was all,
I love
all
80s records, man.
You know, there's not to say I don't, because I do. There are great parts that I love, but I hear it, and it's just like Grandma's Kitchen. It's not a song necessarily.
It's listening to P-Fast Sprout way over here, getting ramping up.
Yeah, but they didn't have a typical 80s drum sound,
pretty
you know.
Slick.
Well, we're not talking about slick. We're talking about 80s
overproduction.
Crap.
Well, that's what I mean.
Yeah. Because you could doesn't necessarily mean that you should. And I think that's what came to life. Just like back in school, Segwayville. We're talking about recorded material. Is this GarageBand classics? This is the only place anyone's ever going to hear this? Or is this something that is pre-production
that's
going to be on
the next
record?
Right to say that it might be the only place anybody hears it.
Cares to hear it,
but,
yes.
Gene Champagne produced and recorded
it's
it for us.
It's Champagne, thank you.
Champagne, yes. Yeah. He's not French.
Is he French?
No.
He very well might be, actually.
Gene?
It would make sense.
Eugenie? All those consonants are hard.
Yeah.
Jean?
Did he Jean produce Champagne? It? Was he the man of the mics?
We...
Definitely.
Yeah, he produced it, yeah.
Yeah, we recorded at his place. And he had a lot of great input.
For sure.
I guess that's producing.
I don't know how, like, you started talking to him about doing something, I think.
Yeah, so we've been friends for a year. Like, even before the Killjoys, we've been friends. I've been friends with Gene.
It just goes to show you how bored he was.
He says that's a pretty, you know, he's held his hair. He looks pretty good. I bet
looks good.
He's probably
he does,
got some songs in
he
him.
Looks good.
I've held
he's
his hair when
songs.
He's thrown up in the toilet.
He's adorable.
The two of you. You got to stick together, right?
He doesn't throw up from alcohol anymore, though. It's just
tossed into the ocean. So
he
went in there.
He's sick.
Just from exhaustion.
And he said, what do you got? And he just recorded some stuff, like top to bottom, live off the floor with some dubs. How'd you do
that? No, live off the floor.
Not at all.
I wish we could have done it live off the floor.
Brick by brick.
Yeah, we had to do it brick by brick, which...
I like that, too.
We owe Gene a lot, because he recorded... Like, you know, we're just going to his house all the time and recording, and then we'd go away and he would just work on stuff for a long time.
Yeah, spent a lot of hours.
By himself, and then he would go, well, hey, how's this? And we'd go, well, holy shit, that sounds great.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, he is a super good guy, as are so many of the people in this scene, and this is a super great song. Back in school, Eyerollers on BarbershopPodcast.com.
Gonna box up the booze. September crashing in. He's sick with the flu. No more holidays. Museums and local zoos. Men in ponytails. Back at tattoos. No more festivals. Caught up in the crowd.
together.
It's not always as beautiful as the sunrise on a Bali morning.
That's very true. But with a nice bottle of Beaulieu.
That's right.
I think it's Beaulieu.
Beaulieu. Love.
That's what I said.
The social media. Took a beautiful panorama photo right there. Gonna get that out on the gram. That's what we call it, you know.
Oh,
us hipsters.
That's what we call it.
Gram. Right. And was it the Facebook?
Yes.
The Facebook. Out on the Facebook.
Is that still on?
But let's talk about that. Being, I don't want to say we're old, but
yeah,
we've seen a few things, right? And learned some skills as far as survival and getting through in this business. And lo and behold, kind of a lot of things we were bitching about become available, right? It's like a lot of things where you had to wait in line, you had to know somebody, and you couldn't afford to do this, and there's just, and now it's available to us.
Well,
but
this is a perfect example.
Exactly. Yeah. And just like the production of music and videos, and at the same time, we've seen, and we've touched on this upstairs, the fact that in the early 80s, you could see a major show for under $20. And now it's $200, $250, and there's been a generation.
A lot of bands that we like can still go for
smaller prices.
Yeah. prices.
Not arena rock.
No one cares.
Right?
Yeah.
But truly, like, these were major acts. And if the only place that kids can see a band is in a licensed establishment, ideally they have to be 19 to get in there, unless the band someone could put together, which, you know, I hope happens, and that we, you know, start showing these young kids how awesome live music is, find the way to do that. But I'm going to ask you quickly, what do you remember as your first live show, you know, that you kind of saw where it was a real rock band, and you saw it either at a high school or a gym or a church or somewhere, and snuck some booze and out back with your buddy sort of thing? Like, what was your first?
It wasn't like a small place. It was an arena show, but it was an early memory seeing Stevie Ray Vaughan open for Robert Plant at the old gardens there.
Like Honey Drippers?
It was,
after,
yeah.
Honey Drippers.
Oh. Well, they played a bunch of Honey Dripper stuff, okay. So the dividing line, but Stevie Ray Vaughan opening, it was just, and I was, you know, drunk with my Serbian friend, drinking Schlievo on the way.
My dad made this.
I think he was lying down by the end, but I stood through the whole thing. Yeah. And Stevie Ray Vaughan was just, like, it was just so obvious how powerful he was and amazing he was, and that stuck with me.
Yeah.
You know?
What would you, Grant?
Well, I was going to say that as well, because I was at that show.
Ditto. I was lying down.
But you know what? A memory I still have is seeing a band in my, just a high school band in my high school gymnasium, and hearing how long he hit the cymbal and just being struck with how long that cymbal
shimmered.
Sustained for.
Yeah.
And that's always, I think about it quite often, actually. I was not high.
It is. No, it's a moment. It's like a snapshot moment where it's
so
like,
I couldn't believe.
That's...
Yeah, it's like I'd never heard it that close, and how it just didn't hear like a. It didn't sound like a record. It sounded like
live.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It was pretty amazing.
What about you, John? What was your?
Well, Kevin, if you got a few minutes, I could ruminate.
Truncate.
I have an older brother who is a rock and roll obsessive, and he took me to see XTC when I was in third grade.
Nice.
At Hamilton Place.
Nice.
Yeah. So it was obviously, it was amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And at that age, that's great.
Yeah, and I love them. I love them. Like, it was Drums and Wires, and I had the record, and Making Plans for Nigel was a big hit, and yeah, it was
great.
Crushing.
Three,
it was crushing. They were amazing, yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
Great stuff. And actually, a little side note before I go over to you, the gray wire that we're using in the sound that's going from this box into the Soundcraft and then into the Apollo and back into the Soundcraft, all the gray wire is from Hamilton Place.
Nice.
So the very show that you listen to probably traveled those three copper wires.
Seen some amazing shows at Hamilton
inside
Place.
There. Magic.
The Cults.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's cool.
We got lots of free wire. It was so good. But I thought about the history, you know, about
traveled
down that wire over the years. All right. What was your early musical?
I got a couple too. Like, Grant's story made me think of one where I was in a high school band and we went to go see like a coffee house at another high school in Kingston, and there was this drummer who everybody had like heard of, and like, well, he can't be that good, come on. And he was like, they played this band that was
his
like,
name was Johnny Faye.
It was not Johnny Faye. No, Johnny Faye's the guy who rides around in Kingston the convertible with the top down blaring. It was like this band was like a combination of like kids from different high schools.
Yeah.
So it's like all these music geeks combined into one band, and they played Roundabout by Yes from start to finish. And it was like, it was incredible. And that was one of like the moments you're talking about, of like, just everybody was just like, oh, they're not gonna, oh, they're doing it. Oh my God. And then you know, the whole crowd just funnels onto them. And I quickly, like, I'm ashamed to admit in hindsight now, but a friend of mine in high school decided that it'd be a good idea on like a Wednesday night to drive to Montreal, which is like 2.5 hours from Kingston. And we saw Primus at the Metropolis.
Sick.
That was amazing.
Yeah.
But it was, again, one of those things where like, I know Primus, right? Like, Primus is not my thing at all. No, but in high school, they're nobody's thing. Yeah. I know. But it was, again, one of those moments where they started. And it was like
you let your guard down and something that magic happened. Yeah. I often tell a story when me and Ryan hadn't seen each other in like 7 years.
Ryan loves Primus.
And we...
right?
Yeah, he does. He's
a Primus fan. Oh, we can talk about him.
You know, he has no mic to defend himself. So, but we went and saw Men Without Hats at the Casbah on Monday night. Too. And they were so good. So good, you know, just the professionalism there. Probably, there was tons of people.
You remember that?
I've been dancing
around. Oh, yeah, for sure. All right, do another live one. What's this one you're going to do for us?
Mallorca.
Okay, I'm going to introduce it. Mallorca. I love it. Am I saying it right?
Yeah.
They asked me to play a tambourine in the background, so it's going to cut through the mix. Eyerollers on barbershoppodcast.com. Another great product out of Hamilton, Ontario. You want to know a lot of great products out of Hamilton, Ontario? You can get them from A to B, from top to bottom at...
I'm going
to
shake that thing.
Yeah. I was shaking it.
Oh, I got to go louder next time.
Oh, no, you do it.
Okay.
All right.
Next time.
I was hiding.
Don't hide, Kevin.
I was hiding. Don't hide my
Black Mamba?
My candle under a bushel.
Don't hide your candle.
Whoa. Zing, zing.
Whoa. All right. HamiltonArtists.ca. They are urban Hamilton artists. They are Hamilton artists. They are our friends, our sponsor. They are the people who print anything on anything. They print everything on everything. It's not like they go from one end of town to the other just printing on things. But if you want something printed on something, if you want a banner, if you want a t-shirt, you want a sweatshirt, a hoodie, you want a pen, you want a golf tee, you want a vinyl wrap of your vehicle, the front door, the tables in your restaurant, if you want to laser etch something into stone or into wood, if you want to lay a foundation brick that is going to have your message of hope for future generations, if you have a creative idea and you need to get that message out, you need to get a hold of Hamilton artists, you know, from the most mundane thing, you know, they can print it. But if you've got an idea and you need to get somewhere and get it done, Hamilton artists are the people to do it. Check them out. They are located at 627 Main Street East. Unit 102 between Sanford and Burris, of course, in the great city of Hamilton, Ontario, at 289-396-1653. That's www.hamiltonartists.ca. And check them out. Tell them Kev sent you. And shop local. Support the people who support you. All right, Eyerollers are in the studio. They're on the show. It's a great treasure, a great pleasure. I mean, because you guys are exclusive. You just don't whore yourself out and play anywhere
and
do the chicken wing circuit.
You would,
but it's like you just sit and you like, you know, he's got to be good looking. He's got to drive. He's got to smell good. He's got to have good shoes, you know. And you, sometimes, sometimes it's like you just wind up. It's like, wow, who are those guys? Like,
nobody
they're so good.
And do you know what? We want to play, but then we start loading things out of the basement. We're
it's,
like,
it's a lot of
what
work.
Are we doing?
It's like, this was fun in the day.
Like, remember when we could just be on the couch?
And Fisher would beat people up.
Oh, my God.
It would be so much fun, you know?
Does Fisher watch the show?
He does. Well, he's up. He's just discovered the internet, and he's...
He's definitely not watching.
And he admitted to the government he exists, and they gave him money, so he's kind of okay with the whole thing now. Yeah, so...
For him.
He's living at a on a boat, even in winter, right? He's fighting coyotes kind of thing.
Wow.
As you would expect.
Well, he was always a big proponent of bear repellent.
It's true, and he's told a story about...
It was shooting. There weren't a lot of bears.
Meeting the blueberry eating black bear this summer, because he's in a 5-star resort, as you can imagine. He's kind of like Relic from the Beachcombers, and it's like it's a $5,000 a year thing. And Fisher's in there, and they're like, "Oh yes, Mr. Fisher," and they put him way up, away from the other people, which he loves because it's up near the bush, whatever. Yeah. And he does his bush, you know, and lives up there.
Tell him to call his parents. They're worried.
They should, you know, they need to get him because they don't even know if he's alive or dead. I remember I did that once. I put a bunch of, like, a dozen socks in his mailbox, and it just fucked with his head. He's like, did my mother find out where I live, you know? Somebody cares about if I've got socks or not. And we do. I hope you're watching, Chris. And one of the greatest roadies in the traditional sense of the word.
He
would lug your gear. He would fix your pots.
He does great
solder
work.
Stuff.
He does great work. And he was like a pro with Varga. Like an actual total pro. Yeah.
Absolute pro.
Can I say, Kevin, to you... you steered us towards Disc Runner.
Mm-hmm.
They've been very, very helpful.
They are great people, aren't great, they? Yeah. And if you've got something done, get a hold of us or get a hold of Disc Runner and say, you know, you heard about it on Barbershop Podcast. They were a sponsor of ours. We continue to give them the good word because they've always done right by us. I think they'll probably match almost anyone's price, but don't have said that. But the prices are very
amazing,
good.
They're amazing,
Prices are very good. All right, what are you going to do? We have to do a recorded one now.
Okay.
Turn around. This is probably your opus. People say that, you know, there's not a... that this is probably the greatest song that's ever been written, and this was from... Paul McCartney himself, you know, he said that when he was in Hamilton.
Yes.
Yeah.
Rumors have it that this is factual, that there is a degree of factuality within that statement that may or may not have a probability of accuracy.
Paul McCartney.
Okay.
Yeah.
He said
that.
I think it was Paul McCartney.
Paul McCartney? Okay.
He was playing at the Gladstone.
But that guy, regardless, has got a great ear for music.
Yes.
Turn around. It's just another great song, right? Like, is there a message? Is there a story?
I hope so, yeah.
Is there a funky story about it? Like, otherwise,
no,
I'm just going to introduce it.
It's about being a hopeless young romantic and being left out in the cold.
Yeah.
That's what I want to hear. And this is what you want to hear on Barbershop Podcast.
Don't be a hopeless young romantic, kids out there. Where's my camera?
.com.
Is it you?
rock and roll has a sacred formula. It could be like bread, it could be like beer, it could be millions of years old, but it exists. For something to be rock and roll, remain rock and roll, and be effective as rock and roll, branding oneself as rock and roll, what are the elements when somebody asks you, because I imagine you get asked, like, what do you guys play? Well, we play rock and roll.
Yes.
What kind of, you know, so what are... the, you know, the things, because we can't help it, but to start to analyze.
The number one thing.
Jean, yes. Jackets?
Yeah. No. Yeah. He's on something.
Curly
honesty,
cords?
Yeah, and you have to get that across in a fairly quick...
Yeah, you can't bullshit rock and roll.
Yeah.
It's either you are or you're not. I think, you know, there's some rock and roll bands that take themselves quite seriously, but if the music is honest, you can forgive that.
Yeah.
We play... our music is honest. We're not trying to do anything except... play our songs,
yeah,
but we're all a bunch of idiots doing it.
Yeah,
you know, and I mean, then, we don't take ourselves seriously at all.
And there has to be some interplay, and I know when I was doing it, I had to have. I'm sorry, I didn't care, but there had to be a guitar solo in it. There had to. Every song had to have a guitar solo. I'm sorry, every song had to have a guitar solo. It's just like, well, no,
they're
you know,
fun.
It's
yeah,
like you get a verse, chorus. I mean, you can mess around with that, but I believe that there is a group of people who that's meat and two veg. That's a song. And
but there's lots of people that, especially I guess, late '90s, early 2000s, when that whole sort of that rock R-A-W-K, like that taking the piss out of it, almost tongue in cheek rock and roll. I never got it. I don't think any of us got it.
Yeah,
because it was almost like an insult.
Yeah.
You know, these people that were sort of making fun of it. It's like, you don't make fun of rock and roll.
Yeah. I like my rock and roll fun.
Yeah, but...
not funny.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly.
Oh. Well done. I'm going to write that one down. Because they've been calling for the demise and the end of rock and roll forever and ever and ever, right?
It's dead.
It's true. You believe
it
to be dead? It's dead because...
you know what's not dead? Basement Dundas.
Yeah.
It's
still playing.
It's still alive.
Yeah. It's a hotbed.
All right.
No one cares. No one cares.
No, the bed is actually hot.
The bed is actually hot. We're right by the furnace. You see glass furnace. We're actually shirtless by a furnace.
All right. I will play louder this time. Make them care and do another live tune for us. What are you going to do?
You shake it.
So we're doing the new one, right?
What's it called?
It's called Every Time I Look, You Look.
Make
you
sure
look.
Lots of time changes.
Every time that I look, you look.
Okay.
Some good wah. Some good sensual wah for Grant Marshall. The leg
Where'd
works.
That come from?
That's a new one, right? That's,
talking.
Yeah, it's not on the record.
It's not on the record. That is a treat that you get only here in Barber Shop.
We write about one a year. .com. That's it.
Yeah, it's
that's
true.
The one.
The one. And that's it's like everything one. Else. It takes a little bit
We're
longer.
Just play
it's,
it in the basement.
It's a bit harder than it was, you know, in the day. But the quality is there. I mean, you're at the level of craftsmanship now. I mean, all these years of working, you don't want to waste your time on a bad song. You know when to spot one early on and when to chuck
contraire.
It. It's like really? Yeah, you lug it. You lug it. You
we
lug
like
it.
To beat it. Yeah.
maybe all it needs
awful.
Is a little bit of this.
Oh man.
It's yeah, we'll true. Play it for a year and a half and then go, this
That's
song
not
sucks.
Great. That's not
Are you
great.
Sure there's not one or two or five more things we can do to make it a little bit better? That
oh,
doesn't
man.
Play
Let's
out.
Let's really struggle through this piece
what
of shit.
What about this part? You go here and I go up here?
No,
it's so
no,
sus.
It's not working. So not in the least. No. All right, because we're a bit experienced and have been around musically and listened to a lot of stuff over the years, there are... You know, all kinds of people who listen to this show, you know, from all over the world. A lot of young whippersnappers. Now, for those people, we'll throw a name out of someone that you think maybe somebody should check out. Someone that maybe we take for granted, but formed a kind of basis of a whole sound or style that they may be familiar with or be quite famous, but don't know who the origins are. And some of the, you know, a name of somebody that somebody should get on the YouTube and do a little musical university study on somebody. Because I think these guys are kind of knowledgeable about who was kind of cool, and especially guitar rock, you know. Let's narrow it down to that.
You said a big one earlier, I think, that combines the nice melody and pop with pretty rock and roll fun shows, and that was the Cheap Trick, the yeah. Live at Budokan, and Bun E. Carlos yeah. smoking his fag the whole time.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah,
it's great poppy, but it's so rock and roll.
Yeah,
it's fantastic.
Yeah, it's fantastic. Cheap Trick. If you're yeah. not familiar with them or you only heard one or two songs.
Maybe, you know, Free is
Free,
a great fucking band.
Yes. Free is a great
just
band.
A four-piece. Well, same as Cheap Trick, but just so much space, but still rocking.
More yeah. hair, though. More hair.
And you know,
tons of.
But there's a sound. There's a genealogy. There's a DNA strand.
More weed.
No, I'd like to
yeah.
count on Bill's dress,
Shad
but
weed,
a good one.
More weed. Weed. Yeah.
More
yeah.
weed. All right, who do you got? Who? What is the name that you?
Pretenders.
The Pretenders, also very good.
100%.
Yeah, that it was. Had a kind of a bunch of different names for it. That was an interesting era, the end of the 70s, mid, late 70s.
Yeah, Joe Jackson in there.
Joe Jackson.
You know,
those
sounds
great
stuff.
Yeah, never came out of nowhere.
I'm going to pick like a, you guys pick bands. I'm going to pick, these guys are going to roll their eyes.
Eye roller.
Glenn Coach.
What?
Glenn Coach is a drummer from Wilco.
Oh, yeah. Man.
He's amazing. He is amazing.
Oh, he's incredible. He's incredible.
I thought we'd go through one podcast.
I know, without talking about without saying the word for milk.
It's gotten that bad.
No, he's like, okay,
we just couldn't get there.
Okay, you guys have to just hear these
yep.
three
Boy,
three
I'm listening.
Sentences.
I'm listening.
He's like, he's one of the most like musical drummers. And he does these like offshoots where he does like, oh, yeah, I'm doing a percussion album, which... No.
Excuse me?
And he does like albums where he just plays all the percussion, and that's like a thing. And I don't check those out at all, but the music, like... In a band.
So does.
Okay, I do not. Yeah. I do not, I swear.
It's like listening to Steve I record.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, God.
Sick.
Yeah.
But he's incredible. He's incredible.
Okay, that's
so
great.
So for like the young, the whippersnappers.
The other drummers who
yeah,
wanted like.
He's incredible.
Could just any musician, musical fan.
Yeah, I believe
Wonderful.
Wilco.
All right. Good
I
stuff.
Like Wilco a lot, too.
Thank you, Grant.
All right, the last of the three Wilco. That you brought in here that we managed to get off of you, then you can check these tunes out on SoundCloud. Or well, just keep watching the podcast over and over again.
We're going to have, well... We're going to release a record,
yeah,
Kevin.
So when is the record slated for?
We're going to play a CD release party in April.
Nice.
At the Casbah.
Casbah Lounge.
Casbah.
King and Queen Street in Hamilton, Ontario.
Yes.
Too. Yeah.
In the middle of April there. I think it's the second Friday.
Nice.
Yeah, and make sure all those Japanese fans that are watching, you come over for the
you
show.
You come. The flights have never been cheaper right now. The Canadian dollar is depressed.
Film. We don't know yet.
Okay. Bill? Don't know.
You're
Bill
watching
Majoris.
This? Well, Bill is with the Foreman Films might be on the bill with us.
That would be sweet.
If
yeah.
Bill will get on the bill with it. Can I see
That'd be
that?
Sweet. I will come I will around. Nudge him. I will
well, no, he's
him.
Just, he's a busy guy. He's recording like eight records a month. And he's
Yeah, every time I get
I
on
think
the
he
show.
Actually fashions the vinyl. himself.
Does he? He melts it and like.
Yes, he's like.
Hand scratches. Yeah. Yes.
From it. Some That's of his favorite records.
He's a control freak,
all that
right?
Mojo.
Stevie Sue would know.
Word.
See.
Word. All right, we're gonna hear this last one until you're gone, till you are gone. I can't really start slurring it and making up my own version of the title.
Yeah, if you want,
till you are gone. I don't know. We're gonna play it. You're gonna hear it. We're gonna
have a song called Both Ways.
Pee break, and then we're gonna come back. They got one more live one after this, but this is another one from the record, which is coming out in mid-April at the Casbah. Follow,
on
check
Universal.
Them out. Eyerollers on Universal Records. Universal, but spelt a bit different. All right, right here at barbershoppodcast.com.
Take your time with everything you do. Realize all the things you've got won't break your heart. Falling down, everybody does. Outside of you for the rest of your days.
Good stuff. Till You're Gone, Eyerollers. Check them out. They're going to be your new next favorite band. Gotta love them. You know what it is? It's tax season. It's upon us. It's arriving in the mail. Your T1, 2, 3, 4s, whatever, something with a T on it from the government. You gotta pay that. You gotta pay that. If you don't gotta pay that, then they're paying you. And you're panicking about it. And you got your stuff and you haven't filed in a couple years. It does not matter. We got someone. We know someone right there. Taxes done right. Get your taxes done right. I get my taxes done right. Ryan gets his taxes done right. Everyone gets their taxes done right. You should get your taxes done right.
Am I right?
Yeah, absolutely right. All right. The yearly T-forms are set to arrive soon. Call 905-529-6453. Do it. There it is. What can I say? It's something that needs to be done. If you go to H&R Block, this is much less money. If you go and get it done and there is a benefit or there is something that is due you, the people over at Taxes Done Right do a bang up job. If you are a client of Boxo Studio or probably even a guest for this show, mention our name, you probably get a little 5% discount, something like that. Every little bit helps in this cruel, brutal world. All right, tax is done right.
what is the bar that?
Thank you.
The bar that used to sponsor you. They're closed now?
Well, they've turned into a different bar. There was a third stabbing. They had they had multiple stabbings. So, right. I mean, I don't want to say
you
stabbings.
You only did one of them.
People fell into multiple knives on a number of occasions.
It does happen sometimes.
Yeah, yes. But they. I was thinking about that today because we got pizzas as well as the sponsorship money.
What was it called again?
Shenanigans. And there was shenanigans. So I need to do that. I need to go out and I've got some ideas and some people who are definitely going to be part of the stewardship in advertising and being part of Barbershop Podcast.
Scotty's not a sponsor anymore at the moment.
No. People go seasonal here and there, and that's cool. But we're looking for someone going to be a charter sponsor, going to be on, and someone who is in the music business and someone we can do something. Because we're always looking to make more venues viable, make them in different parts of the city, don't necessarily have them all clustered in one spot. And they say there's 70 clubs in this town, but there's 4 or 5, you know, that are music clubs that are specifically...
Music,
I do.
Music City thing, don't you?
I do. I think that it's close to being something that could be something, but it's so easily squandered. And people throw around the fact that it's a music city, like it is, springs out of the ground, and you can only.
Hamilton's always been, since we were kids, people. They're just everybody's in a band. Mm-hmm. Everybody's in a band, and people who are in bands go see bands. Yeah. But people. Yeah. Civilians don't go see bands.
No, let's just say 80% of the audience is the same people. Bands, yeah. And I've seen that go from 200 to 150 to 100.
Absolutely.
And so it's the same 50 to 100 people now.
But we're dying.
But I absolutely know that if you could just get somebody to go see at least one or two and say, I don't have to spend $200. I can go once or twice a month, and instead of going to a movie all the time or instead of doing something, I can go that live music is an option. And I just think that I don't know if it's a matter of going to someone's house and beating them over the head and throwing them in a white van. And then driving
you know what it takes is having a club in Stony Creek that people are going to go to, or a club up on the mountain the bands are going
to
play in.
I want a show to end at 10.
And then another show starts at 11. Yes, no, and then
I can not go to.
No, and this is what I've thought too, right? There's crossover with age. Genres are intergenerational. So be it the rock and roll, the country, whatever. There's guys in their 20s and guys in their 40s playing that music, and there's no reason why the old guys can't play 8 to 10, and the young guys play 11 to 1, and then some of the old guys are going to stick around and watch these young guys, and some of the young guys are going to come in early and check out these old guys. And I thought, boy, oh boy, that's something that I've talked about it for a bit, but I think you got to start doing it because some. You got to take the beating, right? Take an 8 o'clock show. No one's going to be there because this is what's happened in Hamilton. It used to be Ontario was very regressive, and it was 1 o'clock. Everything closed up at 1 o'clock. So 12:30, when they wanted to close up, they geared the music so you're going to play till the end of the night. And then all of a sudden, the drinking hours got extended to 2 o'clock in the morning, and the bar owners, being bar owners, are saying, okay, I want 3 hours of music. So I'm going to start at 2 a.m. and go backwards, and that means 11 o'clock. It means the music starts at 11 o'clock. So if I want to go out and enjoy music, I have to wait for 10:30 or 11 o'clock for it to go on.
Also getting City Hall to put some money where their mouths are.
Yeah.
They always talk about Hamilton's a music city and sort of take advantage of that when they see fit, but they don't put any money into it.
No.
The city council had nothing to do with the renaissance of James Street North. That was all artists. That was people wanting to open up things.
We lost your mic somewhere,
Son of a bitch!
No, because what you're saying is important. It's that City Hall, and I said this too, that they say it's an industry, and they sell cab rides and hotel rooms and restaurant meals off of it being an arts, being a music city. And yet other industries get direct financial support. They get backdoor and side door financial support. And what does the music industry get? It gets nothing. It gets lip service from the municipal government that is purported to value it so much. And it's a failure of an understanding of the mechanics of how this thing that it is, that we are being bold and we are being brave and we're putting up with less and trying harder, but it is dying. It is being choked off and not being supported. And if it is, in fact, this is not feelings and arty farty stuff. We're talking dollars, economics, and you know.
We often wonder how people, like God, all the power to you if you can do this as a living. That's commendable. But Jesus Christ, how?
Yeah, and anyone, and the sad part is if you for some reason decide I have to leave music and I have to go get a job and do this, people in the private sector look at someone with music in the resume and they see a flunky and they don't understand that that person is incredibly entrepreneurial, they're hard driving, they've had to learn the craft, they've had to learn to sell the craft, and if they've been a band leader, they've had to learn all of those skills of putting together gigs and putting together the personalities all within business. A band and supporting people. It's just, and you see it all the time where it's like as soon as you put that in, that's a kiss of death because someone who doesn't understand sees it as an easy out.
Not great in a resume.
Yeah, they see just that's an easy out. You're
thrash band.
You know, so. You know, another thing I'm going to do is have a employment service because, of course, if you're a musician, you do 5 or 6 other things. You're highly skilled, so I should have an employment agency that hires only musicians to be your plumber, your babysitter, your dog walker, your whatever. So you got to have these other things done. You want to support the music business, you can't make it out. Well, at least hire somebody who has music as what they're doing their day job for to support. All right, we're walking the dog. We're beating it. We're not beating. We're beating the dog. All right, we got one more song. And we're going to call it a night. What are you going to do for us to call
it?
We're
going to do some...
Big Star?
Do some Big Star.
Big Star, yeah.
We're going to end on the cover.
Yeah. So we're going to do a cover song?
Yeah.
Of our Alex Chilton, one of our greatest people we love. All right, Big Star here done by Eyerollers on BarbershopPodcast.com. A beautiful thing every week, beautiful thing tonight, guys. Thanks so much for coming in, sharing what is the essence of rock and roll.
Thank you,
I love it every week. I tell everyone, it brings me up, it gets me through. It is my hump day when I have the honor to have people on such as yourself on Barbershop Podcast.
Thanks, Gary. Thanks, Ryan.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Thank you.
Thank you, Gary. Thank you, Ryan. All right, guys. Take care. We'll see you next week on Barbershop Podcast. We love you.